I will sing to the Lord. 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 'Cause he is high above and lifted up. He is high above and lifted up. And I will sing to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord. 'Cause he was there for me in the desert. He was there for me on the mountaintop. He was there for me when there was no water. He was there for me, and he gave me a drink. And I will sing to the Lord. I will sing to the Lord. 'Cause he is high above.
Center in. We want to take advantage of the time. Seems that life gets so crowded sometimes, overwhelmed with so many things. And right now we want to press in. Lord, we press into you. Lord, we seek you this morning. We want to lift you up. We want to gain intimacy with you and a perspective that can only come from time spent with you. So we've carved out this time, each and every one of us, to commune with you.
You alone, all my light when I can't see. As praise goes up, I believe the walls are coming down. Oh, when I was lost, you rescued me. When I was bound, you set me free. As praise goes up, I believe the walls. My sight. the falling way, like waters rise, flood this place. We reach for you, we cling to you, oh Lord.
Holy, 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 Saw me through.
kingdom come here. Let your will be done here in us. Jesus, there is no one greater. You alone are Savior. Show the world your love. King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come. Oh, King of heaven, rise up. Who can stand against us? You are strong to save. In your mighty name, King of heaven, come. We are children of your mercy, rescued for your glory. We cry, Jesus, set our hearts to war. Every eye would see you lifted high. King of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come. King of heaven, rise up. Who could stand against us? You are strong to save. In your mighty name, King of heaven, come. King of heaven, shining like the day, King of heaven, come. King of heaven, rise up. Who could stand against us? You are strong to save. In your mighty name, King of heaven, come.
Lord, we've invited you. We ask, Lord, come. Once again, be enthroned. Be lifted up and be enthroned. Be enthroned.
Be lifted up. Be lifted up. As we bow. Be lifted up. Be lifted up. Be lifted up. As we bow down. Be lifted.
Thank you, Lord. for being here in this place at this time for these, your people. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The Spirit of the Lord breaks every yoke and every bond and everything that would hold you back from what you were intended to be. And we came together this morning to be reminded of the truth, did we not? Did anybody need a little reminder this week, or is it just me? I think there's a few of us that needed that. And we are grateful for his grace, are we not?
Nice.
For without that, I think we'd all be sunk, wouldn't we? Thank God for his grace. Why don't you take a second, stand up, and turn around and greet each other this morning, would you please?
Evening calls me close, deeper into this love that won't run out, won't dry up, won't let it rain, won't let it rain.
Good morning. Welcome to Refuge. Yeah, right? You know, after a tough week, I always look forward to church. And so my daughters this morning reminded me how great it is to go to church. And they're like, hey, we're not going to miss it this morning, right? It was like 7:30 in bed. I was like, oh, no, we're not. Let's go. So I'm glad I'm here too, and I'm glad you guys are here too. So welcome to Refuge. We're going to have communion today, and I'm going to get through these announcements real quick. Those of you that have been attending our Beach Bible Studies, we have those Thursday nights at 6 p.m. This week, Jeff and Christine have been so gracious as providing our food for us from the get-go. So what we are doing this week is we're doing grilled barbecue chicken. They're doing the grilled barbecue chicken, so all we need to bring are sides, whatever you guys want to bring besides the barbecue chicken. So we're there at Tamarack between towers, what is it, 33 and 34 or 32 and 33? Just look for the refuge flags. So we're there at 6 p.m. Thursday night. It's a great time. Come out. Fishing trip. Guys are going to be going on the fishing trip here, what, in a couple weeks, 17th, 18th. You guys are sold out, right? Sold out for the fishing trip? Right on. That's great. So what we need to do now as a church is pray that it's just not a boat ride, like a long boat ride. So pray that they actually catch some fish. You guys are not fishing with nets, are you, Howard? Okay, just making sure. All right. And then another way to stay connected besides the, as we're on break for our Bible studies, but another way to stay connected is with the Drays. They meet on Monday night, I believe at 6:30. Drays, where are you? Raise your hand, Mike. Drays are back there. They're back there. So if you'd like to meet on Monday night, 6:30, it's behind me. The signups are in the on the tables there. So you can definitely stay connected that way or come to our beach Bible studies. Also, as a reminder, we try to keep these side doors closed during our service so we can keep the air conditioning nice and cool for you. So we like to use this side door here only as emergencies. So if you need to walk out, just use the main sanctuary doors, and we appreciate that. And lastly, our birthdays. Any birthdays out there? No birthdays? Oh, you guys are making it easy on me. Say again. Jeff Davis? Jeff, did we sing to you? If we did, we're going to sing again. We did? You want us to sing again? No. You want to do it again? I might as well. When you look as good as Jeff does, we're going to sing again. No, stand up, Jeff. That's great. All right, any other birthdays? We're good? All right, here we go. Wait. What?
Oh, that's right.
No.
Alicia, too? Yes, Alicia, you got to stand, too.
Alicia?
How many people here think Alicia should stand up? Okay, represent, kid. I think Shauna should have to stand up, too. Yes, you look lovely today. Me. We all got the key now. You guys ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, Jesus loves you. Happy birthday to you. A couple of things. To be praying about. We got sick people. Now let me see if they all come to my mind, like right now, because we just loaded in. Oh, Anna got sick in the middle of our setting up this morning. So she had to go home, and then Blue had to take her home, because Blue and Anna are married and inextricably connected. So be praying for Anna. She's not feeling well. That's going on. Then Lee, Pastor Lee, just the other day sliced his foot wide open. He sent me a really nice, gruesome picture of a bleeding foot. It was cool. I'm glad he did it after lunch. But was he working in his flip-flops, Linda? Is that what was going on? Because that's what I'm suspecting. What? His sandals, yeah. So you're never supposed to do construction in sandals. Can I get an amen? So Pastor Lee is watching right now. We're going to all chip in and get you some work boots, my brother. So Anna's there. She's hurting. Lee's hurting. We're praying for his healing. Also, Tony. You guys remember Tony? Tony, we got him the wheelchair and, you know, he was going to have one leg amputated, and they didn't. He is still going through healthcare Gehenna. So just be praying for him and his family. as well. Marty, how's your mother-in-law doing? She's okay? We got to pray for her too. Yeah, a lot going on here. That and I think, oh, I can't miss the big one. Lucia. I gotta dime Lucia out. She needs prayer. She was riding her bike. I talked her into riding her bike yesterday because she's a cyclist. I don't know if you know that. And she is a rabid, avid cyclist. So she drives her car all the way. I loaded up the bike. I got everything ready. Drove it. She drove her car all the way down on the other side of the riverbed, and there, up in past Mission on College Boulevard, there's a park there, and you can get on the trail and get on your bike and drive 7 miles into the coast, and then she'll go down, ride to La Jolla, come back before lunch. I mean, that's the kind of rider she is. So she was on the path yesterday, and she had just left. She got about 3/4 of the way to the coast, and some guy was just tooling on a bicycle, and he had a cigarette hanging out of his mouth, and she figured he might have been under the influence of something, but she was yelling, "On your left, on your left, on your left, and your other left," and she was trying to make his way around, and just as she was getting ready to pass him, he just wheeled right into her, and off the path Lucia went, and she scraped up her side, her leg, her arm. I had to help her up and down all last night. We went to the emergency room. There's nothing broken, but she certainly has got a few bumps and bruises. So if you're wanting to give her a hug, would you please just like high five her or something and just help her out? And then just pray for me, because I'm probably the world's worst nurse. Just absolutely horrible. So, pray for her. And we're just glad you're alive, honey, because I know that I would probably get incarcerated if you weren't alive. I know that you keep me from so much harm. So, before we release the kids and we receive the offering, let's pray for these folks. Yes, sir. Jesse. JJ, that's right. We got to pray for JJ. We don't know. That's right, man. How could I forget that? Go ahead. Why don't you tell us? Give us the first hand update. Go ahead.
Okay, this is my son JJ.
Yeah, hi, buddy.
So he's got a big head, like his daddy, right? And the doctors were worried that his head was getting too big, and they went and they did an ultrasound to try to look for something, for a reason why his head was getting so big. And they didn't find anything wrong with it for what they were looking for. But then they might have found something else. So JJ's got to go and get a MRI on Tuesday to look into that. So it's, we live in a fallen world. And we have frail bodies. And the doctors, they go and they look for one thing and they find something else, because, that's what doctors do when they got all these.
Take it away.
Just say hi. but I believe that he's perfectly fine.
Yeah. David, Mario, come on up. Richard, come on up. Come on up. The rest of you guys, Lucia, come on up. Everybody kind of aim a hand this way. We're going to pray. Father, we lift up little JJ to you. We ask you to have your hand upon him, that you would heal him, that you would restore him. God, that you'd bless the doctors that guide him, that will be working on him. And God, I pray that they will bring an early solution to this issue in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen.
Amen.
So once again, we lift up Toshi's mom to you, Lord, And we ask you, God, to be gracious and great. We know you to be that way, but we're praying for you to be gentle. And Lord, we pray that you would give them strength as they care for her constantly. Lord, I want to pray for Tony. Pray, God, that you would comfort him and his family and bless the doctors that attend to his needs. Lord, this morning with Anna, God, would you raise her up? Would you bless her? Would you just restore her to health? And God, just have your hand upon Blue. As well, we want to continue to pray for Lucia. God, that you'd cause her to heal and get stronger, and that you would bless her. And Lord, for those that we haven't even named yet this morning, Lord, we lift them up to you as we struggle with different things, from ringing in the ear to arthritis to pains we can't even identify. God, we just pray that your hand would be upon each and every one this morning. Lord, would you bless our tithe and our offering? Lord, would you expand the work that you're doing in our lives, through our lives, to other lives? In Jesus' name, amen. Young people, you are dismissed to go to your prospective classrooms. Ushers to come forward and receive our tithe.
I'm healed. By your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished, it is done. By your stripes I'm healed. By your death I live. The power of sin is overcome. It is finished. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I was a prisoner. Now I'm not. With your blood, you bought my freedom. Hallelujah for the cross. Hallelujah for the cross.
If you do not have a Bible, please pick up your hand. One of the ushers will get one to you. We've been looking at places to move to, and I've seen a couple of really cool places. So continue to pray. Continue to pray that the Lord would direct and guide our steps as we look for our own place. Just got a call two weeks ago from the family. They wanted to do a funeral, but we just couldn't make it work. I have to call friends that I know that have a church or have a sanctuary that's open. So it's kind of a trial when we're thinking about doing things like that and reaching out to people like that. So they didn't want to come to my house for the funeral, so we couldn't find a spot. So we're kind of doing a park thing next Saturday at 10 o'clock in Carlsbad at Poinsettia Park, and it's for Tracy Duma and his family. So if you can make it, 10 o'clock, Poinsettia Park on Saturday, this coming Saturday, that would be great. The family would be encouraged for sure. I know his sister took it really, really, really hard, so continue to pray for the Duma family. Let's pray. Father, once again, we ask that you would bless this, our Bible study. We came together this morning to receive communion and to remember you, to think about you, lift you up, and to become, even more so one with you. So, Lord, would you bless each and every life that is here and everybody that's watching online right now, and God, would they sense that your Holy Spirit is speaking to them this morning in these few minutes that we get to spend together. So we, once again, we lift it up to you. Lord, take my mouth, take my mind, take my body. Just cleanse all of me and speak through me to your people in Jesus' name. Amen. There are so many voices in our world that are competing for your attention. Have you ever known a time in your life where there were so many people screaming about so many things? And it seems like, people on the right, people on the left, everybody's screaming, everybody's angry, and I think it's just the the nature of our world. It's the way that the world, our country for sure, is in, you know, all kinds of unease and passion and all. And with everything that's going on, there are all these different voices that are competing for your attention, from the tweets that you read to, you know, things on Facebook. Everybody goes off on a little diatribe. There's certainly websites and news outlets, and everybody's got an opinion, and everybody's got a voice. And it doesn't matter where you go. It's just that everybody, and I mean everybody, is talking, and the conversations are really getting ugly, aren't they? I mean, it's crazy what's happening in our world. And I want to say this, and I hope that some of you are going to kind of reflect on yourself a little bit as I say this. But your life and your language and the way that you're speaking has everything to do with the dialogue and the voices that you're allowing to speak into your life. You will always reflect the voices that speak into your life. So I think more often than not, we really need to be cautious about what we're allowing to influence and affect our thinking. A classic example was this week. We have our beach Bible study on Thursday, and I love it because we get fairly close to the sidewalk, and we had chili cheese dogs. Now, I am a passionate chili cheese dog eater, particularly with diced up onions, not cooked onions. Those onions, it's a white onion that makes my wife hate me and not get close to me, but those diced up white onions on top with chili and with cheese. I mean, there were some amazing chilies that we had, and it was wonderful. Well, last week we saw there's this guy that parks right by where we have our event between towers 32 and 33. We're right by the Biffy or the porta potty that's over there and a couple of trash cans, so we're strategically placed. But this guy has strategically placed his 32-foot bounder right smack dab where we set up. Now, I didn't see him last week. So I didn't know they were in there, but you know, I didn't know what was going on. This week, the bounder's still there. So I'm like, did he move, or you know, what was the deal? And now I'm seeing people, the door is open, and I saw a leg, and what we noticed was that there was another car parked right in front of the bounder, and it was kind of just barely touching the handicapped parking spot. So Lucia said, keep your eye on that white car, because when it moves, we can move our truck up, and because we have the refuge Tahoe, we can move the truck up, offload all of the tables and chairs, and we'll get that parking spot, because that's primo. And so we're there early, and we're sitting on our beach chairs, and we're looking at the water, looking back at the bow, and we see that the white vehicle has moved. So immediately, I take off running. I get into the Tahoe, I pull in, and I'm going to tell you what, it was like Top Gun. You might as well call me Maverick, because the way I pulled that Tahoe in was nothing short of a work of art. And I got it within inches of the bounder, okay? So there I am. Little did I know that the white car belonged to the people in the bounder. And they were just running down to 7-Eleven to get a Slurpee. And so I have totally jacked their spot, okay? So they're a little bit irritated anyway, all right? So there they are, and as we're, you know, hanging out, we're talking, they come up and they say, you realize that it is bad etiquette for you to park that close to a motorhome. It's just not done. And he said, I have some friends, and he told me I used to be a UFC fighter. You know, he wanted to throw that in just to make sure that I understood that I'm dealing with a man with power. And so I was like, wow, that's great. He didn't look like UFC, I'm just saying it. But he just didn't, he was unassuming. So the other thing is he was about three sheets to the wind. If you understand what that means, it means this, that homeboy was loaded, okay? And so we were, you know, and I was like, you know what, I'm really sorry, but I'm with this group and we're having you know, chili cheese dogs. You want chili cheese dogs? You're having chili cheese dogs? Oh, yeah. Do you want to come? Well, yeah, I want to come. And he brings his girlfriend in, and we're all, it's actually his wife, and they're hanging out, and they're kind of hovering. They're hovering the whole time. And you could tell they're not real healthy emotionally. They're just kind of there. And you know, a couple of people came up to me and said, Howard, who are these people? And why are they here? And it's like, we're in Carlsbad. You know, we're by the beach. Let's have fun with this. You never know what could happen. And so I'm talking to him, and we're talking, Lucia's sharing with his wife, and all of a sudden, his wife, you can just see, she starts talking about some of the things that have gone on in her life, and I'm talking painful things she was bringing up. You know, I always deal with, you know, when I deal with people with addictions, honestly, there are significant reasons why they're in addiction, okay? It's not just because they wanted to party. It, you know, oftentimes people have really, and things have happened in their life that has really destroyed them. And so this started flowing out of her, and her husband was kind of rubbing her shoulder and just kind of hovering and kind of there. So they enjoy the chili cheese dogs, they hang out, and I start sharing with his wife after the study, and she's just sobbing. We end up praying, and she's receiving the Lord right there on the beach, and her husband doesn't know how to cope with this, because we were talking about, you know what they were doing. She said I was an alcoholic, and he's like, well, I'm not an alcoholic. I just like to smoke a lot of weed. And so I was like, you could tell he was pretty loaded. And so after I finished with his wife was just thrilled and walked away and was helping clean up, and he starts in on me. And he's like, the earth is heaven. We are in heaven. As a matter of fact, I'm God, and God is in me, and you know, you are here, and we are here, and we are all together. Cuckoo, ka-choo, you know, that kind of thing. I mean, it was going off in these really bizarre extrapolations about reality, and there's everything's feelings, and there's no such thing as truth, and all of that kind of stuff. And I just got into the middle of all of this huge conversation with this guy, and I realized, and I remembered my journey. As I was talking to him, I remembered, I'm a nut just like this guy. You know, I would come up with all these weird things, like, you know, there's a galaxy in my fingernail. You know, there could be like other planets and stuff inside of us. And, you know, there was all these weird kind of extrapolations that I would come up. And it just reminded me of where I came from and how much my life has changed from then until now. And how wonderful, you know, they told me that they had sold their home, checked out on life, and now they're living in their Winnebago. And I'm thinking, what a drag. I mean, I understand you want to be free and all of that, but still, you're just sitting around getting loaded by the beach in a Winnebago, and is that all there is to life? But it just brought me back to everything that God had done. And this is exactly what's been happening in our Bible study here in Luke. I mean, Jesus is talking and he's sharing things, and people's lives are being completely revolutionized just simply by the incredible things that he was sharing. And so there in verse 28 of Luke 9, we read, it came to pass about 8 days after these sayings. I'll just pause there. Jesus has been talking tough. He's been sharing some hard things. He talked to his disciples about his rejection, about his suffering, about his death, about his resurrection. And I think by the time he got to resurrection, everybody had checked out because they were all in on what Jesus was doing. And they were hoping that he was going to change their culture and change their living situation. He was the promised Messiah. There was an invitation then by Jesus towards self-denial. I mean, self-denial about accepting crucifixion, actually inviting it, just like Jesus did, to follow him. And then he says, if you lose your life for me, you will find it. But if you try to save your life, you're going to lose it.
And what good is it if you were to gain the whole world but lose yourself in the process? And then there's the warning that comes out of him. If you're ashamed of me in this life, then I'm going to be ashamed of you when I stand with my Father in heaven. And if I'm Judas, and you know Judas is probably like one of those millionaires on Shark Tank, you know, at this moment he gets to that point and Judas goes, all right, I'm out. I'm done. I mean, at this point I have to think that Judas is one of those guys that subscribes to this principle, and it comes from the author David Mitchell, whoever dies with the most toys wins. But I subscribe to this, and this is what Jesus is saying. Whoever dies with the most stuff dies. I mean, that's kind of the end of it all. And Jesus was uniquely speaking and saying the things that were so unique that they were unsettling and life-challenging. They were transforming. Continue on, verse 28. Now it came to pass about 8 days after these sayings that he took Peter, John, and James and went up to the mountain to pray. Why then? I'll tell you what, I've read volumes on this. And people say, well, Jesus was grooming them for a leadership role, and he always had them with him. You know, in chapter 8, when he raised Jairus' daughter from the dead, who did he have? He had these three guys, Peter, James, and John. So they were saying that he was always, you remember the garden in Matthew when he was in the garden and they were sleeping in the garden? He brought those guys with him into the garden. So some think that they had a special, unique kind of quality, that they were being prepared for something. But I have a theory. As you all know, I theorize quite a bit. Not quite as much as my friend in the Bounder, but certainly I theorize nevertheless. And here's my theory. I think Peter, James, and John leaned in every time Jesus was talking. I think Peter, James, and John hung on every word that they heard. I think Jesus was well aware of the fact that these guys were paying attention and they were being drawn in. And so whenever you draw in, Jesus will draw you out even farther. And, you know, I put it this way. In Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, part of it, the second part of verse 2 says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of the mind. And as they were listening to the words of Jesus, they were being not only drawn into him, but drawn away from their culture. The message, Eugene Peterson puts it great, Romans 12, 2. Don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Which is classic, because when you look at verse 29, this is what we read. As he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered, and his robe became white and glistening. In Matthew and Mark, they use the Greek word metamorpho, which means metamorphosis, which means a change from the inside out, not from the outside. It means transformation from the inside out. So verse 30, amazingly, we read, and behold, two men talked with him who were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, which he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. This is huge. I mean, Moses, he was the great lawgiver, and Elijah, he was the great miracle worker. He was the one who was speaking to a nation. Two completely different people who were voices speaking to a nation. Moses, he led his people out of bondage and slavery, where Elijah was calling his people back into faith and to trust and to honoring and walking with God. So there's Jesus. I mean, wouldn't you love to have been to that conference? What an incredible Bible conference that would have been. Moses, Elijah, and then Jesus is the cleanup man. He comes in and wraps it all up. But when you read about what they were talking about his decease. Did you see that? Here's the word, decease. Do you know how it translates? It's going to freak you out. Exodus. They were talking about his exodus. Jesus is about to deliver a planet, and this is a seminal moment in history. Moses might have been the lawgiver. Elijah might have been the miracle worker. But Jesus, he's the Messiah. A unique moment in history, to be sure. Verse 32. But Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep. I can't help but think that Peter, James, and John often felt that prayer time with Jesus meant nap time with Jesus, for sure. They had no idea that they were about to enter into a holy moment, a moment with God that would leave an indelible imprint on their lives, and they started out the moment by sleeping, which is, for you and for me, a shining example, and this is what it is. Are we any different than these guys? I'll never forget, I was in Europe with a bunch of guys. We were praying, and we had just flown from LAX, then we went to LaGuardia, then we jumped on another plane to Frankfurt, Germany, then we went from Frankfurt, Germany to Budapest, Hungary. After we got to Budapest, Hungary, we jumped on a bus and went for about 12 hours north to the north of the Hungarian border. And there we were, and we felt like, okay, let's all get together and pray. So all these guys are praying. And I get to about the third guy, and there's about seven of them around me. I get to the third guy, and I am out cold. I'm sleeping, but it's one of those. Have you ever done that in church where you kind of find your spot in the pew and you sit down and you give it the reverent forehead pose where you're letting people know that you're deep in pontification over the inner workings of the scripture? You know what I mean? Like this. Inevitably, it's happened to me a number of times where I pull that one, and then all of a sudden, I don't know if you've ever done this, but all of a sudden, your elbow goes off of your knee, and you jerk up, and everybody knows now, oh, he wasn't being reverential. He was asleep. So there I am. We get to the last guy right next to me, and I'm sound asleep. What I don't know is while they're praying, a couple of them have begun to do a little sign language, and they're waiting, because if I'm asleep by the time it gets to me, they're going to pound lumps on me. That's the way we were. We were just like that. One of the guys, if I was sleeping in a prayer, they'd grab you and just pound lumps on your head. And so I know I'm in for it. And these guys are all Italian guys. You know how Italian guys can be, real rough and disagreeable. Anyway, I'm not being prejudiced at all. So I'm there in my repose, and they could tell I'm sleeping because I'm doing that deep breathe, you know, the deep. It's like just under a snore. And by the time the last guy says amen, by divine working, I woke up. And as soon as I heard him say amen, I go, yes, Lord. And immediately I launched into some extemporaneous thought. You know, I just blow it out there. And they're like, you were sleeping. After we finished, they were like, you were sleeping. I'm like, what are you talking about? I don't know what you mean. Jeez, what's with you guys? Man, we're supposed to be spiritual here, and you're all trying to find me sleeping, you know? Gosh. But that's where, are these guys any different than us? Not at all. This is why I love it. These guys are in the inner circle with Jesus, and they can't even stay awake for a couple of minutes while the man prays, you know? It gives me comfort. How about you? Verse 32. And when they were fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. Then it happened as they were parting from him that Peter said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. I mean, Peter injects him. It's like saying, why don't we all build a tree for it? We'll do one for you, one for Elijah, one for Moses. We're going to do three different little tabernacles. It's one of those, Mose Allison wrote a song and it went like this. Your mind is on vacation, but your mouth is working overtime. It's one of those moments, I get comfort from that. Not only does he fall asleep in the middle of a dynamite spiritual moment, but as soon as he wakes up, he's so shocked, he injects himself into it with a great idea for building tabernacles. Poor Peter. So look at verse 33, right at the end, not knowing what he said. I like what Abraham Lincoln said. He said, it is best to keep one's mouth closed and make people think that you're perceptive rather than open it and remove all doubt. So there he is. Mark says in Mark 9:6, because he did not know what to say, for they were greatly afraid. So as Peter looks at the scene, he wants to perpetuate. He wants to keep it going. So in verse 34, while he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were fearful as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son. Hear him. That's like saying, Peter, put a sock in it. When the voice had ceased, Jesus was found alone, but they kept quiet and told no one in those days of any of the things that they had seen. In Mark 9, chapter 9, verse 9, now as they came down from the mountain, he commanded them that they should tell no one the things that they had seen till the Son of Man had risen from the dead. They needed to see this. Peter needed to see this. James needed to see this. John needed to see this. Why? Because they would never forget this moment. The Father was communicating something to Peter, James, and John that they would never forget. And here's the only thing I wanted to leave you with this morning before we receive communion. And here it is. Elijah, the great miracle working prophet, every miracle he did pointed toward Jesus. They were pointing to and kind of trying to shine a light upon Jesus. Every prophecy ever spoken was to point to Jesus. And I'm going to ask you a question this morning, folks. Does anybody in this room really need a miracle this morning? Anybody? Let me hear you. Anybody? Does anybody need a miracle this morning? I want you to remember this. Your miracles can only take you so far. They can deliver you out, but they can't lead you in. I want you to remember that as you're seeking a miracle. Moses, the great lawgiver, does anybody need some direction this morning? Like, are you on the brink of a decision that needs to be made? Hello, am I talking to anybody? Tell me. Do you need some direction this morning? Directions can always take you out. This is for people who are in programs, who are doing a process. Directions can always take you out, but they can never lead you in. You need more. You need more. The law had always, coming from Moses, he gave the directions, but the law could get them to the promised land. But to get the promised land into them, oh, they needed something more. In Galatians 3, verse 24, it says this, the law was a tutor to lead us to Christ. You know what we need? We don't need a miracle, and we don't need directions. You know what we need? We need a Savior. We need to get saved. We need to walk and trust and walk with a Savior who can save. Everything that God has been trying to communicate through the ages from day one has always been pointing to Jesus. Know that in your heart and your mind. Do you remember what Jesus said to the two guys on the road to Emmaus in Luke chapter 24 in verse 45? I'll read it. You listen. These are the words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and the prophets and the Psalms concerning me. Peter Piper, who pipes in and almost just by asking for tabernacles desecrates an incredible holy moment. He wrote these words in 2 Peter chapter 1, starting at verse 16. He wrote, for we did not follow cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For he received from God the Father honor and glory when such a voice came to him from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. And we heard his voice which came from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. He'll never forget it as long as he lived. He had to have been thinking, what was I thinking? Who needs a tabernacle when we've got a Savior? Who needs a building? Who needs Elijah? Who needs Moses when we have a Savior? You know, I've even read that in some commentators' minds that Elijah and Moses were there to kind of comfort Jesus because he was freaking out because of where he was going. I totally understand that, Christ and his humanity and all of that, but I think it's more than that. I think if I'm Moses and I'm talking to Jesus and he's getting ready to save humanity, let me ask you something. Why do you think Moses is there? Moses is there because he trusted that God would provide a Savior. Why do you think Elijah was there? Elijah was there simply because he trusted that God would provide a Savior. Can you imagine the incitement in these two individuals when they're standing there being translated from a cloud out of glory right on a mountaintop in their country, standing and talking to the Messiah? I'll tell you what, it wasn't Jesus who was getting encouraged, it was Jesus who was encouraging them. I mean, this is the beauty of having a Savior. This is the glory of walking with a Savior. This is the only reason why I'm even here today. I mean, Jesus didn't need the comfort, they did. And as a matter of fact, I can almost hear Moses' voice saying to Jesus, I could take them out, but I couldn't get them in. And Elijah said, I could call them back, but I couldn't get them back. But you, do you realize what you're... Do you have any clue of what you're... Do you realize how amazing this is going to be? At that point, I can only think that Jesus, with all the bravado of John Wayne, just walks out of that crowd, ready to go to Jerusalem. Let's go. It's like Schwarzenegger on steroids. I'll be back. He's coming. Oh. That's communion, by the way. I want you to see the cup and the bread for what that means. The cup is his body given for you. Broken. The cup is his life poured out for you. But I want to take it one step further. Why did he take Peter, James, and John up there? And why were Moses and Elijah there? I'll give you one word. Here it is. Love. Love. It's kind of like what Jesus told Nicodemus there in John chapter 3. He said, for God so loved the world. See, his body given for you, his life poured out for you, is nothing more than him reaching out and saying, I love you. I love you. I love, and when I'm talking to the guy in the Winnebago, his breath is it's like, it's iguana breath, okay? His breath is dragon breath. I mean, it's knocking me out. And I'm sitting here and I'm talking to this guy and I'm seeing myself and I'm realizing the passion and the love of Christ pouring out through me into this completely crazy individual. And all I could do was not look at him and say, listen, bro, you're going to hell. All I could do was say, listen, you're missing out on God's love. And I wanted to just read this before we launch into communion. I wanted to just read this one chapter. Can I read a whole chapter to you this morning before we launch into communion? Because I want you to translate your communion into this chapter. It comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all the mysteries and all knowledge, and all, though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned but have not love, it profits me nothing. Can you see Moses and Elijah marinating on this? Love suffers long and is kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade itself. Is not puffed up. Does not behave rudely. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. Thinks no evil. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth. Bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never fails, but whether there are prophecies, they will fail. Whether there are tongues, they will cease. Whether there is knowledge, it will vanish away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part will be done away. When I was a child, I spoke as a child, understood as a child, I thought as a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then I shall know just as I also am known. And now abide faith, hope, and love. These three, but the greatest of these is love. God, we celebrate the communion this morning, the cup and the bread that speaks of life laid down and life poured out. And if the cross speaks anything, it speaks of your love.
And I thank you that you would willingly touch the likes of me, one who would sleep in a holy moment or desecrate it by foolish talk. But Lord, you come in and you love us anyway. We fix our minds and we focus on you this morning. Jesus. The ushers are going to bring the cup to you. You'll have bread on the bottom and the juice is on top. We'll take it together. Ladies, if you please.
Tree, bled and bore my penalty. I'm alive and I am free. The cross was meant for me. Took the fall, paid was meant for me. Man of sorrow, Lamb of peace, the wrath of God was placed on thee. Where all grace and justice finally meet. Oh, thank you for the cross. Mercy, mercy, what love poured out of thee. Mercy, mercy, the cross was meant for me.
Thank you for your mercy.
Mercy, mercy, what love poured out of thee. Mercy, mercy, the cross was meant for me. Man of sorrow, Lamb of peace, the wrath of God was placed on thee. Where all doubt and justice finally. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. The cross was meant for me. The cross was meant for me. The cross was meant for me.
As we look at the bread, I thank you for what you willingly did for me. The blows that you bore, the stripes that were laid upon you, were all for love. And when I look at somebody in this world who speaks and spews hate, or is resentful, who displays prejudice and exerts violence, I remember that you love them too, and that I was once the man in the motorhome. I've had some weird thoughts, but you loved anyway. I think all of us are there, Lord. We understand, Lord, even more now this morning. And with gratitude, we remember you and your body that was broken for us. Thank you. Let's all partake together. Now, as I look at the blood, the cup that represents your blood, it was poured out. And as you bled, you did that willingly. And the sacrifice was made, and the blood was sprinkled on the altar, which was just going down on the dirt. And I realized once again, it was to cleanse me from my sin. And Lord, you know all of us who have cup in hand need cleansing. The things that we've spoken, the things that we've done and the things that we've thought and felt and responded to. Oh, Lord, would you cleanse us? We remember you and your love, your cleansing love poured out in crimson red. So as we take the cup, Lord, we remember you and thank you. Let's all partake.
Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. Thank you, God, for saving me. The cross was meant for me. The cross was meant. The cross was meant for me.
I want to leave you with a thought. Because now you're going out. And I know that you're going out and you're going to face people. People who don't agree with you. I know this is going to come as a shock, but I think there are people out there that don't like you. One or two, yeah. But I want you to remember what he's done for you. To bring you in, draw you close, should you sleep or say something goofy. He goes anyway to Jerusalem. And he carries a cross, he marches up a hill, and he lays his life down. And if you were the only one, he'd have done it. Because he loves that much. That's passion. And so you're getting ready to go out into a world that's hostile, and that's filled with anger and hate, and trying to reform life through legislation, through election, through moving and changing and trying to clean up the environment. And although those things are honorable discourses and ones that we should have conversation about, never forget the bottom line of your life. And that is, a list of rules could never change you. And any miracle that God could ever provide in your life would not draw you in and change you and transform you. Only a Savior can do that. And I got to tell you, that takes an open heart, a closed mouth, and a willing spirit. Would you all stand with me this morning? I want to bless you, you missionaries, you refugees. You missionary refugee type people. I want to bless you. May I bless you? Hands up, please. Father, I pray that you would fill each one in the room this morning as we have honored you. We have looked to you and we have acknowledged you, your saving power and your transforming love, your forgiveness and your grace and your mercy toward us. Lord, make us dispensers of that grace and that mercy. If we be strong, let us be strong for your glory. If we be weak, let us be weak for your grace. And in all things, be lifted up in and through us. Rise with healing in your wings, each and every life this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you guys. I love you, and I'll see you on Tuesday. I'll see you.